and peace be to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You know, there are some things that only happen in church. I made a short list, but maybe you can think of a few more. So first, ask a stranger to scoot to the middle of the row. When you come into worship, it is totally acceptable for you to ask this of anyone sitting on the aisle to scoot to the middle. That's how it works here. But try that next time you fly Southwest Airlines. Not sure it'll work out for you. Second, talk about raising dead people. In church, we talk about people being raised from the dead all the time. So Jesus' friend named Lazarus died. And to make a long story short, Jesus proved God's power to the people by praying and crying out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" But in the real world, that's like playing hide and seek in a cemetery. Come out, wherever you are. Real life is not an episode of The Walking Dead. The Gospel of John reminds us that when we talk about Lazarus, just as when we talk about Jesus and the whole picture of faith and the very life of the church, we're not talking about death at all. We're talking about life. Because stories of resuscitation and resurrection are not told for the dead, but for the living. This week, I was doing a little digging and heard some people share a little bit about Zion's history and the awesome courage in faith and life that is harbored here and shared with the world. And I found that 20 years ago, Zion was among a handful of congregations who were approached about relocating to a fast-growing area of West Manchester Township. There were other churches in need of this resuscitation and growth, but Zion was the only congregation to accept this invitation, to receive new breath and the challenges that go with it. This venture in faith, as we still claim today in our mission statement, was the beginning of Zion's 20-year presence on this hill, and that we'll celebrate in December. The relocation brought new life to a faithful congregational family formerly located downtown. In this story of new life, the similarities and differences between the history of our congregation, the raising of Lazarus, and the resurrection of Jesus can't go unnoticed. The stories of Lazarus' death and resuscitation, and the crucifixion and resurrection of the Lord are quite similar. Lazarus is brought back to life in order that the people might begin to grasp and believe that which is to come. The story of Jesus' crucifixion on Good Friday and resurrection on Easter, so that we, the people, could see the power of God at work and believe. But the differences between these stories are what really drive the promise home. The main difference is resurrection versus resuscitation. Lazarus was given new breath to his original body. Jesus was resurrected into divine glory with God. The difference is that when Lazarus died and was raised, he came out in his original earthly form. He came out resuscitated. He was given new breath, and still he wore the burial clothes that bound him, as if he was carrying this experience of illness and loss on his person. And as Mary tells us in John's Gospel, Lazarus smelled really bad. The people in this story see and believe that Lazarus was raised only after the stone had been rolled away. But when Jesus is resurrected into divine glory with God, the stone that covers his tomb isn't even moved an inch. And when it's removed, the burial clothes are folded neatly within. Lazarus died and was buried, and after 4 days was raised by the power of God in Jesus. Jewish burial practice is that the soul remains with the body until the end of the third day. Up until that point, the soul may re-enter the body at any time, and people believed that the dead could awake from their sleep. So Jesus waited until the fourth day, the day after hope remained for new life, to go where Lazarus's lifeless body was buried. This was so that the people might see and believe, so that when the time would come for Jesus to die, surely hope remains that he will be raised on the third day, that he will rise in God's glory, and because God became human in him, that when we die, we will rise too and live with God forever. The purpose of new life for Lazarus, the purpose of this resuscitation, is not good news for Lazarus. It's not a gift for him really at all. Later on in the story, Lazarus will be killed. The purpose is that the people will see and believe in God's glory. You know, it's one thing to say you believe something. It's another thing to see it and then to tell the world about it. Here's a true story I'd like to tell you about a family, a mother, a father, and a young girl. They were having a yard sale in the heat of summer. An older woman approached their yard. I'm not sure the family would have taken much notice because there were plenty of other people passing through, except this woman was hard to miss. Wearing a heavy, long wool coat in the dead heat of summer and a thick set of pearls around her neck. And you know, she didn't even seem interested in anything they were selling, but she was fixated on the flowers planted in their garden. So the mother walked up to the woman and asked, "Is there anything in particular you're looking for?" The woman replied, "These flowers, they're beautiful. Where did you get them?" And the mother said, "Oh, I have no idea. They've been there forever. But here, let me get a cup from inside, and I'll dig one up so that you can take it home and plant it in your garden." So she came back outside with a cup and dug up the flower for her to take home. And the woman took a quarter out of her pocket, as if she wanted to pay for that flower. The mother said, "Oh, no, no, it's my gift." And the woman looked at her and said in a serious yet warm tone, "I promise to pray for you." It wasn't more than 2 minutes later, the mother remembered she forgot to tell the elderly woman not to plant the flower in the sun. So she dashed out to the street. But the woman was nowhere to be found. That night, the family loaded up their yard sale items that were yet to be sold into their truck and headed off to their local mission. They were driving down the road when a car suddenly veered into their lane from the opposite direction and hit them head on. Their truck rolled 2, 3, 4 times and landed upside down. The impact was so hard that the young girl was thrown 40 feet from that cab into a field by the road. And miraculously, that family only suffered minor injuries considering the circumstance. But when she tells this story, to this day, that mother swears that as she was being raised from inside their mangled truck, in the crowd that had gathered around that awful scene, that she saw clear as day. The woman from the yard sale standing there. The woman who said she would pray for her. And she knew that God was with them. And she believed. Most people need the confirmation of seeing or experiencing to confirm our believing. You know, that's exactly why Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, so that all who saw it or experienced it might believe in Christ, who would soon pour out his life on the cross, sacrificing himself to save the people from sin and death, to show them that with God all things are possible. But the question remains, why is there suffering and illness? And why is there heartbreak and disease? And why do some people survive and others don't? These are darn good questions. Questions that we as believers need to be asking, to faithfully challenge and wrestle with and pray about every day. God's self-sacrificing love doesn't always make sense to us. The problem is that we try to make God's love a rational thing. We try to reason our way through the meaning of life and death, but that's not how God works. A prime example is that God sent his only begotten Son to be the Savior of the people. God loves us so truly and so deeply that God hands over his only Son so that all of us have a chance at seeing and believing and living into this promise of new life. Now tell me that makes sense. That's how God works. You know, this isn't a story or even a season in Lent about death. As we were reminded last week, this is not a funeral. In fact, later in John's gospel, Lazarus is sitting at the table with the disciples and Jesus and his sisters Mary and Martha, and they are partying because they have seen what the glory of God can do, and they have experienced that receiving new breath from the Spirit can enliven the world around us. And of course, it's a story about love. The women sent to Jesus and said, "Someone you love is ill." Gospel stories are not written and proclaimed for the sake of those who have died. Okay, they are written for people who are alive and who have lost someone in a number of situations, or who are grieving over illness or absence, people we love, or people who have lost their ability to do something, or people who have lost hope that anything good can come from this pain, and for people who are learning how to deal with all that, and how Jesus fits into our loss and into our heartache, and how his presence is a promise that turns our loss into gain, into hope, into new life. The good news is that every day we are given this gift of new life with Christ. Whether you've had a near-death experience or you just need a breather, hear these words of our Lord calling out to you. Child of God, come out and live. Amen.